Today on Studio One, we browse through the award-winning pictures of Eric Bloomer. He was named Photographer of the Year by the National Press Photographers Association. We will also take a walk through one of the most colorful backyards you will ever see. Irene Larson's green thumb creates beauty with every touch. And we'll find out how women are breaking into the rock music industry.
Now, from the University of North Dakota, with Monty Cashel and Stephanie Mars, this is Studio One.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the show. We're glad you could join us.
I notice, Monty, you're wearing your poppy.
That I am.
In remembrance of Remembrance Day in Canada, in Veterans Day, and in the United States.
Right. We have to remember, especially right after an election that we just had, why we were able to vote, why we are free. It's because of all the veterans that risked their lives and lost their lives in the wars in the 20th century.
It's glad there's a day that we can remember them.
Right, and we should always remember that on this long weekend coming up. Also, technology is changing the way we see video images. Dr. Dick Schultz will tell us why we are seeing things better than ever.
Plus, we'll introduce you to a new addition to police forces across the U.S. They're taking a bite out of crime.
But first, national and regional news with Mike Mundahl.
Thanks, Monty and Stephanie. The Army plans to interview as many as 1,000 enlisted women to determine the scope of an emerging sexual assault scandal. At least 30 young female recruits say they were sexually assaulted during their training at the Aberdeen Proving Ground in Maryland. The Army is deeply embarrassed and concerned.
I am particularly troubled by the abuse of power that these allegations talk to. And I would tell you that that is something that offends us all.
Pentagon officials say it appears the Army scandal is far worse than the 1991 Navy tailhook scandal because the sexual assaults are more serious and took place in uniform on base. O.J. Simpson's personal physician took the stand Thursday in the wrongful death civil trial. Dr. Robert Heisengoos says he found 11 cuts and abrasions on both of Simpson's hands when he examined him 2 days after the deaths of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman. He testified that the injuries occurred an estimated 5 to 7 days before the examination. In addition to the testimonies taking place, an 18-year-old intern has decided to quit her position in the court. Amber McGrath says she was made uncomfortable by a party invitation and other tension Simpson extended to her. Her family says she feels her privacy is being violated by the media. Buying a computer can be a confusing task. Terms like mouse and keyboard are easy to recognize, but for many consumers, the words RAM, Pentium, and Gigabyte have little meaning. Before you look for a computer, there are some things you can do to get the best one to suit your needs.
Hopefully they have done a little bit of research or talked with their neighbors or friends or whatever, got a little bit of idea what they may be looking at or been around other computers. If not, we can, you know, expose them, but in this day and age, everybody's been exposed to a computer somewhere along the line.
Purchasing a computer that is right for you can be done, but first you need to decide the major use for the computer and what your budget can afford. Starting out with a basic system that is upgradable may be a way to purchase a computer on a tight budget. Being bald may not be a male thing after all. Researchers have found baldness may be caused by a female hormone. While researching skin cancer, scientists found that a shaved mouse grew hair when it was treated with a blocker against the female hormone estrogen. However, hair follicles are extremely complex and grow in cycles. Scientists say the discovery is a very important biological finding, but it is still too early to apply to people. For many people, wood carving is a great spare time activity. For one man, it is more than just a hobby. It is the therapy that brought him back to an active life.
And in 1990, I was involved in an industrial accident, and I was severely burned in a boiler explosion. I spent 2 months in a burn center.
Cliff could not work with his hands after the accident. For a while, he was sitting home for hours, day in and day out, doing what he called boring exercises, just to be able to use his hands.
And at the end of the day, you didn't have anything tangible to show for it, and I kind of wanted to do something a little different so I'd have at least have something to show for my efforts at the end of the day.
Cliff had his tools modified with foam pads so he could grab them to be able to practice his interest in woodwork.
Also, if you forget about your problems and stuff when you're focused on something else, and I think it enhanced my therapy a lot.
To Today, Cliff's hands are 95% recovered, and he is still one of the 50 members of the busy Beaver Club, where he started wood carving. However, he spends more time in his private workshop, where he makes all kinds of different figures. Numerous wooden figures represent Cliff's effort, hard work, and success following his accident. He gives most of his carvings away to friends and relatives.
This wooden Santa Claus could be a really great Christmas present. It has taken a long time to complete. For a person recovering from an accident, that could be a really meaningful time. I'm Henrik Meyer, reporting from Crookston, Minnesota for Studio One News.
Few believed Cliff would be able to work with his hands again, but after he turned his hobby into therapy, he was able to prove them wrong. That's a look at news for this half hour. Monty and Stephanie?
Thanks, Mike. You know, those wood carvings are really beautiful.
Oh, they were gorgeous. And the intricacy of it.
I'm actually making some wood projects myself for people for Christmas. They're not that beautiful, but...
What types of things do you make?
Well, I guess I can't say in the air, just in case the people are watching, they might find out what they're getting for Christmas.
So it's a surprise. Maybe after
surprise.
Christmas, you'll
yes.
let us know.
After Christmas, I'll let everybody
and
know.
And actually, you probably are spending a lot of time outside because we have had such warm temperatures
yes,
for this time
nice.
Of year.
Mm-hmm.
And now Aaron joins us from the Regional Weather Information Center. Aaron, are these warm temperatures going to last?
Actually, I do have good news for you. It looks like our temperatures will be on the warm side for at least the next 3 days. I know there's a lot... I'll go tomorrow for the big football game. Sioux hockey team 6-0 should be a good weekend to travel, especially on the roads. Let's start by taking a look at our current conditions around the Grand Forks area. Our temperature out there is not too bad this morning. We're beginning to warm up. We're under partly cloudy skies. Right now our temperature is 28 degrees. We have a dew point of 23 degrees. Our humidity is at 80%. Winds are from the west-northwest at 15 miles an hour. Our pressure is 30.03 inches of mercury, and that is falling. And right now we have a wind chill of 14 degrees below zero. That will be warming up, trust me. Okay, let's go on now to our morning map. We can see right now that skies are beginning to clear out right through the central parts of the region. Should make for a nice, bright, sunshiny day out there. Temperatures will warm up. Right now we can see those clouds just in the western part of the region and down to the south. But when the sun comes up, it'll burn away some of those clouds, and we will notice our temperature will begin to warm up just a bit. Now, out to the west, we have a warm front that's going to begin to push eastward. Cooler air in front, warm air behind, and as soon as that front pushes through, it'll probably be later on this weekend, we could expect warmer temperatures to return to the northern plains here, especially in the Grand Forks area. Now, Friday evening, again, partly cloudy skies. Here comes that front in the eastern parts of Montana. Out to the east, they have quite a mess on their hands. A lot of rain from New York all the way down to the central parts of South Carolina. That's where the major weather story has been throughout the nation. But closer to home, I think that we're going to be happy, especially if you have any outdoor plans this weekend. Let's move into tomorrow. There again, eastern part of the region clear. There's our low pressure system out over the western parts of Saskatchewan. We can see that warm front pushing ever so closely toward the western part of North Dakota. And as soon as that makes it here, trust me, I think we'll all be happy campers. Let's take a look at our specific forecast for Friday. Becoming partly cloudy, winds will be from the northwest at 15 to 25 miles an hour with a high of around 35 degrees. Now moving into tomorrow's forecast, partly cloudy skies, winds from the northeast at 10 to 15 miles an hour. High warming up a bit, 40 degrees, and here's our extended outlook. Cooling down a bit on Sunday, chance of scattered showers in the afternoon. Monday and Tuesday, beginning of the work week, warming up, mostly sunny skies on Tuesday, a beautiful day shaping up, 48 degrees. Our lows will be below freezing, but I think our daytime highs of close to 50 degrees on Tuesday will make things very worthwhile. So if you can make it through this weekend, it looks like the beginning of the work week is promising.
Well, thank you very much, Aaron. That forecast was
that
wonderful.
That was great. I can't wait for the weekend now.
I know.
This is going to be excellent.
It'll be sweatshirt weather.
Yes. But overnight, we had a ton of sports going on, and Eric Hansen is here to tell us about it.
Thanks, Monty. A ton of sports. Zeus and Hades went to war last night as three teams put their outstanding records into battle. The only question was, who would pass the test? We begin with the NBA, where the Houston Rockets came to Denver looking to extend their unbeaten streak. And the word is pass, as Mark Jackson dishes one to Antonio McDyess for the throwdown. Pretty like that. But it came taking a few too many steps toward the basket for two of his 36 points. Bernie didn't like that one. Oh, those poor misunderstood mascots. Shame on you, Sir Charles. Barkley and comrades win 110-108 to go 5-0. To the ice, Florida hosting Washington, and the word is pass. The Panthers' Ray Shepard putting his team up 2-0 in the first, but even this goal off defenseman Ed Jovanovski's skate could not help the Capitals capitalize. Florida wins again, 4-2. And over to NCAA football, where the word is, yes, pass. San Diego State's Billy Blanton connecting with Leandrew Childs here for the touchdown against the 16th-ranked and unbeaten Wyoming Cowboys. But the almighty Cowboys would not ride off into the sunset in this one as they lose in the final minute, 28-24. And that's a look at the national highlights. Now we'll look at the overnight scores. For nearly 3 hours this weekend, the state of North Dakota will be split in two as the pigskin flies back and forth. The University of North Dakota Fighting Sioux football team will take the field in Fargo against their biggest arch rival, the North Dakota State Bison. This game will be the 103rd time the two teams have met and is the most played rivalry in NCAA Division II football history. The coveted Nickel Trophy will be on the line again for the 58th time. The Sioux have captured the big coin a total of 29 times. Much of UND's focus will be on the Bison's nation-leading running attack.
They will certainly try and establish, as they've done in every game and done a great job with it, they're running the ball better than anybody right now. But you get caught in the trap of coming up and trying to stop that play after play, and they also have hurt people with some passes because you overplay the run.
The teams went 1-1 last year in two contests as UND won the first game and lost in the playoff game. Both teams are 5-3 going into this weekend's challenge. A win this year could mean a chance at the playoffs and a tie for the North Central Conference Championship. And that's it for this half hour. Monty and Stephanie?
Thanks, Eric. It's 12 minutes past the hour now, and still ahead on Studio One, we'll meet a woman who is as colorful as her flowers.
And imagine seeing an image of your unborn child as if you were watching it on television. Soon, ultrasounds may become more clear.
We're moving you into the future. Tell us what you think. Contact us online. Our email address is udstudio@badlands.nodak.edu. Or better yet, check out our webpage.
Insurance. Unfortunately, it costs. Fortunately, it pays. Voller Insurance, Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
Okay, Sharon, you convinced me. I'm switching to community.
I'm switching to community too. What's it like?
You'll find out.
I'm looking forward to it. Wow!
Columbia, Columbia Mall.
It's a place just for you
to have the perfect rendezvous
with exciting shops and restaurants.
Perfect place to meet.
So meet me at Columbia. Meet me at Columbia Mall.
Meet me at Columbia.
The Army National Guard has been serving Americans ever since there has been an America. And we will always be here, giving our best to our communities, preserving our freedoms, protecting our way of life. We're America's citizen soldiers. We're mechanics, businessmen, farmers, nurses, teachers, neighbors. Proud to be part of the communities we serve. The Army National Guard, Americans at their best.
And pick your insurance company? As your agent and broker, that's our exact job. We think we do it well, and have been since 1947. Voller Insurance, Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
You're watching Studio One, news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
Video image enhancement is helping us see more clearly. It has been used to create special effects in movies like Forrest Gump and in government surveillance photographs. Dr. Dick Schultz joins us today to discuss his research in video enhancement. Thanks for joining us, Dr. Schultz.
Nice to be here.
What exactly is video enhancement?
Well, most people have seen the movie Forrest Gump by now. Mm-hmm. And everybody knows that Tom Hanks never shook hands with JFK. Couldn't happen. There are ways to make that happen using video technology, using digital video enhancement, where you take old footage of JFK, cut his form out of every single digital frame, film a new sequence with Tom Hanks and people muttering about in the background, drinking coffee or whatnot, and combine all those images, put a little noise on it, and make it look pretty authentic.
Well, we have a picture of two pictures, one before video enhancement and one after video enhancement. Can you explain what the difference is?
Sure. Here you see a before picture of the dome at Notre Dame, where I went to graduate school. We took a video camera outside on a cold January day, panned the sky, digitized that sequence, brought it into a computer, and then performed enhancement on it. The low-resolution data on the left has many poor edges. It looks rather blurry. But if you combine multiple frames of that information, you can increase the resolution of what you see on the right. And it really does show an improvement.
Oh, yeah, a definite improvement. Can you also do this with photographs?
Certainly. You can scan in a photograph using a digital scanner into a computer, perform an enhancement technique on it to improve the resolution. You won't get as good of a result if you have a single image. But if you have multiple images in a video sequence, you can get some amazing results from it.
And I understand the government is using it in government surveillance. Is that what they do, or do they use the video part of it?
They are interested in both, actually. The video part of it is relatively new technology. In the last 10 years or so, people have tried to get satellite images to be correlated and integrated so that you can get more detail from the information. And it's working out well. It's a very hot topic of research right now in the image and video processing community.
I see. And as you mentioned earlier, the movie of Forrest Gump, what other types of movies has this been used in? And is it just something that us as viewers don't even know that's happening?
You see it a lot in movies really all over these days. Independence Day from the summer. Everybody knows the White House isn't blown up.
That's right.
It's pretty obvious. Mm-hmm. Pretty authentic, though. They had a helicopter crash into the White House, and it was very authentic. But that was purely computer graphics and video thrown together in a digital enhancement technique. And it works great.
Yeah, well, we're seeing it all the time. And I understand you're doing some research in the medical field. Can you explain that to us?
I'm starting to look at this particular algorithm for use in ultrasound images.
Okay.
I have a graduate student and an undergraduate student working on a project where we're taking ultrasound data, which is very coarse and very noisy, integrating the frames to try and improve what you see, let's say, when you and the doctor having your pregnancy test.
And will that also help maybe with cancer patients and to see tumors a little more clearly?
It's quite possible. Digital radiology is becoming a hot field as well. And if you can enhance digital x-rays or digital CT or MRI scans, that could help immensely.
Okay, you said digital for the CTs and CAT scans and video for the ultrasound. Can you explain the difference?
A digital image is a very general signal where you have samples called pixels at every point. There really is no difference. Video sequences are also digital, but images are single frames from that sequence.
So what type of research, you know, where are you at in your research right now?
I started at UND last year, so I'm really starting at a fledgling point. I received a grant from the National Science Foundation to start this work. It's a 4-year grant, a very nice one, that will let us really extend this work to do much better work in motion estimation, to do better work in image modeling, the real important aspects of modeling a video sequence so that you can integrate this data properly.
What do you see the future of video enhancement? Where do you see it going?
I see it going so far that people will do such a good job with video enhancement, you won't be able to tell if Tom Hanks ever shook hands with JFK or not. It's becoming to the point where it's almost perfection. If you have a trained eye, you can watch Forrest Gump and see the problems that arose, see the things that aren't perfect. But for the untrained eye, very authentic.
Well,
very authentic to the point of being scary.
Right, right. And do you know how long, you know, it'll always be changing and improving? When do you think we'll see the changes in ultrasound?
The changes in ultrasound and medical image processing are coming already. The world's going digital. There'll come a day when you don't go to the doctor's office and have an analog x-ray taken where they pop up a screen. It'll be all on a computer. And that day is coming in 5 years.
Well, I can't wait for that day. Thank you very much for joining us, Dr. Schultz.
Thank you.
19 minutes now after the hour. The sounds of women in the rock industry are changing. We're going to take a look at some new trends, but first we'll show you how one woman's love of gardening has turned into a passion that others can enjoy.
I started out in a one-room country school. It was about the only one left in the state. I thought about being a doctor ever since I was a little kid.
Let me take a listen to you here.
Yeah.
Some big, deep breaths in and out through your mouth, please.
E&D School of Medicine, I feel, prepared me very well. The quality of the education was excellent. I definitely was looking to stay in a rural area. A lot of our graduates tend to stay in state. It's a real benefit to North Dakota.
Statistics show that the average person over a lifetime has 75,302 dreams, 3.8 surprise parties, 563 pairs of socks, and 8.6 different jobs. Is educated by 39.7 teachers, laughs 1.5 million times, finds $8.15 in the sofa, tries 12 different hairstyles, plays 6.4 sports, and owns 3.5 pets. But the average person only has one life, so why mess it up with drugs? A message of 29.3 seconds from a drug-free Navy and Marine Corps.
When the heavens thunder, when the nation calls,
come on.
You can make a difference and be a part of it all.
Find yourself in the Army National Guard, serving one weekend a month and 2 weeks a year, and you'll find an extra paycheck, money for college, and all the adventure you can handle. Call 1-800-GO-GUARD.
In the Army National Guard, you can.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota is steeped in tradition. From the first graduating class, students today learn from the Modern Law Library and computer labs. Students write for the North Dakota Law Review, take part in moot court, and review court proceedings with video technology. Law and medical students compete in the annual Malpractice Bowl.
The size of our student body gives great access to their teachers, and our computer network allows us to access worldwide legal resources.
Look up the UND School of Law for more opportunities.
Fall is a sad time of year for many gardeners. It means digging up their beautiful plants for the winter. We want to take you back to a warmer, more colorful time, summer, to meet a woman and her flowers.
The fragrance of sweet-smelling flowers, along with a sea of purples, yellows, pinks, and reds, embrace all who visit Irene Larson's flower gardens. Irene started gardening with just a couple of plants.
Well, I've been gardening all my life, since I've been a little girl. I babysat for my aunt, and she sent me some flowers home when I went home. And when I got married, I brought them here with me.
Irene claimed more space for her flowers as buildings were taken off the farm. She also says her flowers are not planted in any particular order.
I just didn't make any plans at all. It just comes out naturally by itself. It's kind of an English-type garden. You know, and that's what they are. I mean, here and there and everywhere, tall ones here, and all colors and everything. I just put it wherever there's a spot, I put a plant.
Irene shares her love of gardening with others.
The neighbor ladies, anybody that wants flowers, they've gotten them. Some of them have even taken them off my compost pile. They come over and they see I've discarded some. It's hard to throw flowers away. I guess that's why the garden has gotten so big.
Keeping the garden weed-free is a challenge for Irene, but she says the hard work is worth it.
Isn't it the best tranquilizer there is? To be out and enjoy the beauty of the nature that surrounds you, I mean, it's just great.
It is. It is.
And it's so peaceful and it's quiet and the sound of the birds. Yeah, I wouldn't part with it.
With every garden, there are weeds. Irene says she's worn out many hoes because she spends at least 8 hours a day using one. It has always been a challenge for women to succeed in the rock music industry. Alanis Morissette broke this trend with her record seller, selling 13 million copies of her debut album. Tracy Bonham is trying to break onto the scene with her new single called Mother Mother. Bonham says it's hard to make it because of the music industry's quick jump on what she calls the movement.
Right now the media has gone, ladies and gentlemen, the music industry's newest big discovery, the woman! And I'm thinking, yeah.
Meanwhile, Fiona Apple, another rising star, thinks the music industry's interest in women's voices is nothing new.
I think that there have been women rockers forever. I think that someone broke through, whether it was Tori or Alanis or Joni Mitchell even, you know. And I think that, you know, somebody succeeded, somebody broke the doors open, and record companies jumped on it.
This jump has allowed the industry to choose and dictate what styles hit the charts and what styles don't. Now, time to take a look at the events happening in your area.
Since Magic Johnson admitted he was HIV positive, athletes with HIV have come under close scrutiny about participating in sports. Here are your thoughts on whether athletes with HIV should play pro sports.
Yes, I do. I think that if they acknowledge it and the board knows that they have HIV, that they should be able to participate as long as they make it public knowledge.
Absolutely not. And the reason that I feel so strongly about it, because AIDS is, it's rampant right now. So why should we give it another avenue to go wild?
I think if the proper safety precautions are taken, then it would be fine for everybody to do that. I don't see a problem in it.
Well, I guess it kind of depends on the sport itself. I mean, golf, I can see why, but like physical contact sports, you get a busted nose, broken arm, there's blood all over the place. So it gets a little dangerous there.
I think sports really give people that's involved an incentive in life, and why take that away, you know?
A well-insulated home can save you money during the cold winter months, but there is a dark side to insulation. Carbon monoxide is a deadly byproduct of appliances and furnaces that run on gas or oil. This gas can easily be trapped inside your tightly sealed and insulated home. Without proper ventilation, this colorless and odorless gas can reach doses high enough to be deadly. The risk is easily corrected by taking some simple precautions. Annual chimney cleaning and a carbon monoxide detector should keep you safe.
Well, it would save a life. You have your chimney serviced annually. It could cost anywhere from $50 and up.
Experts are not blowing smoke when they talk about these dangers. It is important for you to identify possible problems in your own home. It's now 30 minutes after, and still ahead on Studio One, our next guest is a peace officer with a partner who can sniff out crime. Plus a look at some of the best video photography in the nation, compliments of Eric Bloomer. That story plus news, sports, and the updated weather forecast in the next half hour on Studio One.
UND's Division of Continuing Education can help you learn throughout your lifetime. Begin or continue your education through correspondence study and learning after hours with classes on weekends and evenings. Or enhance your personal and professional development through conferences, management seminars, and specialized programs.
Our goal is to provide quality programs and extend UND resources to you.
For more information, call 777-4266 or 1-800-342-8230.
At Studio One, we're moving you into the future, and we're growing. Today, nearly 1.5 million people have the opportunity to see Studio One. In addition to Channel 3 in Grand Forks, Studio One can be seen on Channel 2 in Fargo, Channel 12 in Bismarck-Mandan, Channel 19 in Minot, in Crookston, Minnesota on Channel 7, and now on Channel 6 in the Twin Cities greater metro area. You're never far away from Studio One as we move you into the future.
Gee, I mean, you ask the students.
The education that you get is as good as or better than what you can get at anywhere else.
The teachers really go out of their way to help you outside of class.
It's just an incredibly rich opportunity and environment here.
Thank you.
from the University of North Dakota, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One. And Stephanie, you've got some winterizing your home tips for
us. Yes, I do. Even though the temperatures have been pretty warm thus far, you still need to get ready for the winter
season.
This is the time to do it. Turn off any water valves that are not being used or toilets that are not being used if you're not using the toilets in the basement. Set your thermostats at 55 to 60 degrees and check your furnaces to make sure they're in good working condition. And also check your windows to make sure there's not a lot of drafts coming around them.
And you'll save on heating bills and be nice and toasty warm during the winter. Also coming up in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, you may be watering down your IQ without realizing it. Our news team will tell you how.
And we'll find out what it takes to be one of the best photojournalists in the nation.
Plus, we'll introduce you to a new crime-fighting weapon named Nico. And we're not going to let you in on that secret until we have the guest up. But first, we have national and regional news with Mike Mundahl.
Thanks, Monty and Stephanie. The NAACP says it may take action against Texaco, and the organization is urging the government to investigate the company. Some of Texaco's African-American employees claim the company has passed them over for promotions because they are black. This follows allegations that Texaco employees plan to destroy evidence in a discrimination lawsuit. It is a recorded conversation where some of Texaco's senior executives used racial slurs that the company now wants to hide. NASA successfully launched its Mars Global Surveyor Thursday. The unmanned probe was carried in a Delta rocket that blasted off from the Kennedy Space Center. It will travel 435 million miles before reaching the red planet next September. The explorer will help NASA determine whether there was ever life on Mars. It's the first of 10 spacecrafts NASA will send to Mars over the next decade. Because of deep space agency budget cuts, NASA has built and launched this spacecraft cheaper and faster than what is normal. When we think of drugs, many people think of controlled substances and illegal drugs. Another drug problem in the U.S. is the misuse of prescription drugs. Although the problem isn't as large as the illegal drug problem, it does exist, and there are measures that pharmacists use to try and prevent it.
We try and review with the patient how often they should take their medications and side effects that they might encounter, such as drowsiness. Also warnings, such as do not take this while you're having an alcoholic beverage.
Pharmacists around the region also have a network of pharmacies set up to allow them to keep in touch about potential problems. If there is a problem, the pharmacist talks about it with the patient and with the patient's doctor. Drinking a glass of water can give you a lower IQ. Many households have lead in their tap water and do not know it. Exposing children to tap water with lead has been linked to learning disabilities, impairment to nervous systems, and low IQs. A regular blood test can show the level of lead in your body, and there are ways to get rid of the lead. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency says households built after 1986 are less likely to have pipes with lead because of their plumbing. A good way to prevent exposure to lead is to let water run for a while before use and to cook with cold tap water instead of hot. A fuel heating tank in your home can cause environmental problems. The problem can start with a simple leak and lead to an expensive cleanup.
Winter is on its way, and now is the time to ensure that your heating system works properly. Many people use fuel oil furnaces to heat their homes, but your oil tank can be older than they think and cause some problems.
There's a lot of old tanks around that have been in houses for at least 20 years.
If you are one of many homeowners that still heat with oil, make sure that your oil tank doesn't leak.
Oil tanks do spring a leak. Throughout the years, with the moving and stuff, that it does, with the moving of the oil and the stuff in the bottom of the tank, condensation throughout the years, you can develop a leak sometime.
Since oil is getting more expensive to use, people tend to switch to gas heating. Reports from Oregon show the leaking oil tanks are an increasing problem. The state reports a 200% increase in leaking oil tanks. In the Midwest, oil tanks found on farms are often buried in the ground. Underground tanks may spring leaks and cause environmental damage to the nearby soil and groundwater. In certain states, there are laws that require homeowners to inform any buyers of the existence of heating tanks. Even after switching to gas heating, the problem with oil tanks will remain if they're not removed. Homeowners that detect an oil leak will face more than $5,000 in cleanup costs. I'm Paul Mathiesen, reporting for Studio One News.
If your home heating tank leaks, don't be afraid. It is possible to clean the oil spill with a cat litter-like substance. George Burns would be proud. Cigar smoking is on the comeback trail. Cigar manufacturers and cigar stores are experiencing a boom in sales. The trend is similar to the 1930s and 40s when smoking cigars was quite popular among men. Today, both men and women are smoking cigars. This means an obvious increase in sales.
Our cigar business has gone up phenomenally in the past 3 years. Nationwide, the growth is almost 200% from just a couple years ago.
Engen says cigar manufacturers are having a hard time keeping up with orders. Many times orders are late or not complete. Nobody knows exactly why the cigar business has blossomed. Some, however, believe that people like David Letterman and Demi Moore have sparked the trend. And that's a look at news for this half hour. Monty and Stephanie.
Thanks, Mike. You know, our reporter looked awfully cold out there in the field.
He looked very cold. But one thing I noticed, there wasn't any snow in the
background.
And that's, we've been pretty lucky. Everyone else in our region has gotten snow, and we haven't gotten any. And to find out more about that, Aaron joined us from the Regional Weather Information Center. Aaron, is our luck going to remain?
Oh, I think we're going to be okay for the next few days. Portions of the western part of the area weren't so lucky. Walhalla, North Dakota received 12 inches of snow the other day here in the Grand Forks area. We got it dusting. We woke up in the morning and saw some snow. Most of it is gone. So it looks like the weekend should be much of the same. Very nice, too warm for snow, and I'll show you that in just a second. First, let's look at the Grand Forks. Current conditions for this beautiful Friday morning. Right now we have a temperature of 28 degrees, partly cloudy skies, and a dew point of 23. Give us humidity of 80%. Our winds are from the west-northwest at 15 miles an hour. Our pressure is 30.03 inches of mercury, and that is falling, and our wind chill is minus 14 degrees. Now let's look at Friday morning's map. Partly cloudy skies throughout much of the region. That's the way we're going to start. It's going to be a very nice day throughout much of the area. Our temperatures won't be as warm as they will toward the latter end of the weekend, but I think we're going to be off to a good start if you have any traveling to do. Here's a system out to the west that's going to continue to move eastward throughout the weekend. A slower moving system, but we're going to expect it to bring along with it warmer temperatures, especially toward the beginning of the work week, where right now we're looking at a high of 48 degrees on Tuesday. The major weather maker right now is out on the east, where rain all the way up the Atlantic coast is plaguing that area, and it's been there for the last couple days. But I think we're going to be okay here in our area. In fact, today's highs, 30s for now in our region, 40s in the southwestern part of the state. And as we look at tonight's lows, teens through our region. I had to pull out the cold colors. I'm sorry. Hopefully in the next couple weeks I'll be able to pull out those greens again, but I think we're going to be stuck with the purples and the blues for now. 20s in the southwestern part of the state, including Bismarck, and it looks like 30s down toward the southwestern part of South Dakota. Now let's take a look at our 3 to 5 day temperature outlook. Normal expected throughout much of the area, below normal into the Arrowhead regions of Minnesota, and above normal temperatures all the way out into the western parts of Wyoming. Now we look at our 3 to 5 day precipitation outlook. Below normal in our area, which is good if you're not a big snow fan, and the Arrowhead region of Minnesota is going to be above normal, as they're going to expect a little bit of precipitation. So I think we're going to be okay here in our area. A great weekend to travel to Fargo or the Twin Cities, depending on what your plans are. Monty and Steph.
Thanks, Aaron. Well, it looks like a great weekend, and we can not have any snow yet.
Hey, that's all you have to say.
Right.
No snow, great weekend.
That's right.
We have Eric Hansen with sports next.
And we have a great weekend in sports as well, Monty. The University of North Dakota hockey team is off to its best start in 10 years. One of the major factors in the Sioux's start this season is one player who is making a homecoming of sorts. And boy, are the Sioux glad Jason's back.
When most students go to college, they leave home and only return on an occasional weekend or on holidays. But for UND's Jason Blake, instead of leaving home, he came home. Blake is originally from Grand Forks, but for family reasons, he had to move to Moorhead, Minnesota when he was still growing up. But Blake still considers Grand Forks a home.
In ways I do, because I know so many people here, and I grew up here, you know, and for 13 years, and, you know, I know so many people here, and I moved away, and I, you know, kept in contact with these people, and so I kind of consider it my second home.
Blake originally signed with Fair State of Michigan to play college hockey, but he quickly found out that it was not the place for him.
Well, I was there for 2 weeks. I don't know. The school's great. You know, the hockey's all right. It's just not what I wanted. You know, trying to pursue a hockey career, and if I stayed there, I don't think that would have happened because they're not too big on hockey. And
when Blake decided to transfer to UND after his freshman season, he fulfilled a lifelong dream of playing for the Sioux.
My dad had season tickets for you know, since I was 5 years old. And, you know, I got to watch the great guys, you know, Tony Hercus and Bob Joyce when I was growing up, and I always wanted to play for the Sioux, wear the green and white, and dream come true.
Just 3 weeks into the season, Blake has already made a huge contribution to the Sioux. He has already scored 5 goals, including 2 in his first game with UND, one of which was even the game winner.
I was really nervous that game, you know. I was come out and see all these fans, you know. I grew up watching this, and someday I wish I was on the ice and it happened. And, you know, it was a great game.
And despite coming home to play for the Sioux, Blake would not mind leaving town in March to go to St. Paul. That is where this year's WCHA Final Five is being held. Chad Reichow, Studio One Sports.
Blake and the rest of the Sioux hockey team head to Minneapolis this weekend to face the Minnesota Gophers. The 6-0 Sioux will try to equal their best start since the 1986-87 season, when they opened up with 8 straight wins. Here's another look at the scores from last night. And those are the overnight scores. Monty and Stephanie?
Thanks a lot, Eric. It's now 20 minutes before the top of the hour, and there's a new kind of officer walking the beat. It may not be the type of officer you've seen before.
And we'll also show you a photojournalist who sees images in a different light and brings them home to viewers. That story's next on Studio One.
Insurance. Unfortunately, it costs. Fortunately, it pays. Voller Insurance, Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
Okay, Sharon, you convinced me. I'm switching to community.
I'm switching to community too. What's it like?
You'll find out.
I'm looking forward to it. Wow!
We'll be at Columbia Mall. It's a place just for you
to have the perfect rendezvous
with exciting shops and restaurants.
Perfect place to meet.
So meet me at Columbia. Meet me at Columbia Mall.
Meet me at Columbia.
Sioux pride. The championship tradition is strong at the UND bookstore. Before the game, shop the UND bookstore for the largest selection of officially licensed Sioux products. No matter what your sport, the UND bookstore can help you show your Sioux colors. The UND bookstore welcomes all alumni, friends, and Sioux fans. Shop for quality name brand clothing, Sioux collectibles, books, and supplies. Come to the UND bookstore located in the Student Union.
And pick your insurance company? As your agent and broker, that's our exact job. We think we do it well, and have been since 1947. Voller Insurance, Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
You're watching Studio One, news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
If a picture is worth 1,000 words, then Eric Bloomer's photos are worth millions. Eric strives to capture the emotions of the moment and give them to his audience.
When you watch News 4, you're witnessing stories photographed by the best in the nation. Eric Bloomer, the National Press Photographers Association Photographer of the Year.
And I learned how to shoot television news before I even picked up a camera.
Eric Bloomer never dreamed of becoming a television photographer. His dream was to be a musician. And while you may not hear any of Eric's songs in his stories, what you will hear is a rhythm, which Eric creates himself.
You can get anything Parrish.
It's not in the shooting that you capture a style of a story. It's in the editing.
Any size of the nose, a hand, you can do eyebrows, any part of the lip. If you can pinch it, you can pierce it.
But it sort of conveys more of the style, the feel of the people that would go in there and get their bodies pierced. Called The Search for Fletcher Cox. And that was a spot in his story that a three-year-old kid was missing and they thought he might have drowned in a drainage ditch.
With the rising sun, spirits rose as well. Those footprints led into this wheat field, and the only way to search it was from above.
The stories that I've presented on my tape are photojournalism stories. In other words, I'm the photographer, but I'm also the journalist. In other words, I've decided the content of the story. Pretty pictures of hummingbirds. There's a couple hundred of them come to this guy's farm every year, every night.
This is the hummingbird spot as far as I'm concerned. I've never...
Someone said that my pieces have really good... I do a good job using natural light. And sunrises and sunsets and are dramatic lighting.
We'd like to share the little birds with everyone else that we possibly can. They don't belong to us, they belong to God and all of us who can see and appreciate them.
Eric says he has always been working towards achieving the National Television Photographer of the Year Award, but never expected it. Eric has been to a lot of places around the world, and he's seen a lot of things. Some include Romania, others, the one-year anniversary of the Oklahoma City bombing, and the crash of United Flight 232 in Sioux City, Iowa.
And I worked for 3 days straight, and I didn't get emotional at all. They made a movie of the crash, and they actually filmed the movie back in Sioux City with the same volunteers. And I went home and watched it like 11:30 at night, and I started crying because I couldn't, you don't comprehend the scope of what's happening when you're working. And you really, you know, there's no need to. I mean, you're not there to do that. You're there to document it. You're there to shoot.
Boy, those were some beautiful photographs.
Some great shots. And I was actually lucky enough to go to a workshop. He came to Grand Forks for the Dakota Press Photographers Association, put on a workshop for all the local photographers and talked about, you know, composition and all those interesting things. It's great to see through someone else's eyes every once in a while to improve yourself. Stay with us. We'll introduce you to a four-legged crime fighter right after this.
Something you want to know about Studio One, write us, call us, or fax us. Our address is Box 7307, Grand Forks, North Dakota, 58202. If you wish to call us, dial 701-777-4346 or fax your message to us at 701-777-4342.
I started out in a one-room country school. It was about the only one left in the state. I thought about being a doctor ever since I was a little kid.
Let me take a listen to you here.
Yeah.
Some big, deep breaths in and out through your mouth, please.
UND School of Medicine, I feel, prepared me very well. The quality of the education was excellent. I definitely was looking to stay in a rural area. A lot of our graduates tend to stay in state. It's a real benefit to North Dakota.
This is David.
Oh, hi.
This is what David's done. David went to college. Annapolis. David taught himself to play piano, the sax, even the bagpipes. Well, maybe not the bagpipes. David was NBA Rookie of the Year. He's also been to the Olympics, twice. David even became a naval officer. David's sure done a lot. But you know one thing David's never done?
Drugs.
David doesn't do drugs. Maybe that's why he's done so much. When you put together quality faculty with quality programs, with superb students and all kinds of neat opportunities, you're going to get literally a world-class education. And that's what we can provide at the University of North Dakota.
Coming here, you do meet a lot of people from different cultures, and it's really broadened my horizons a lot, kept me more open-minded. I really like the professors here. They're always available. You can go in and talk to them whenever you need them.
it really has everything to offer. You don't need to go far away to get a really good education anymore.
Violent crimes are part of society today, and it's getting harder for law enforcement agencies to prevent and detect crimes. Deputy James Tadman and his canine partner, Nico, join us to talk about the benefits of training dogs to aid police and save lives. Welcome to the show.
Good morning.
And this is Nico.
Yes.
We finally get to meet the crime-fighting dog. What does Nico do every day to help you in your job?
Well, every day he jumps in the car with me, and he sits in the back seat, and I have to escort him around. Nico is trained for, he's a dual-purpose dog. He's for narcotics and patrol work, such as things as tracking, suspect tracks or lost persons, the building searches, area searches, article searches, and he has the obedience and agility, and the apprehension is one of his, the biggest important things that we have him.
Now, I understand in your community, you were the one who started to implement the canine program. How was that in getting that started?
Well, I guess always been interested in the canine. I started doing a lot of digging into it and finding out how many other places there were with canines and how they were utilized and if our department could utilize one and how it would make a change in our department and around our area.
Okay, and Nico is actually Hungarian, am I correct?
Yeah, he's been imported from Hungary.
Does he speak Hungarian?
I give him all German commands. Mm-hmm. I figured it'd be easier just to stick with that than me to try to train him back over for English, so
right.
It works out pretty good.
How long and hard was the training process that you had to go through with Nico?
When we received Nico, I got him down in Indiana, Evansville, Indiana, at the John Haller Canine Academy. And he already had some rudimentary training in him with the tracking, obedience, agility. The main thing was is to train me how to work with a dog and to do the continuous training to keep him up on it. And then we also trained him down there with the narcotics to become the dual-purpose dog.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what is Nico possible to do? Not to give away any secrets to let the bad guys get a hand up on us, but what is Nico possible of doing for us?
The tracking, such as you got somebody that runs away from a building burglary, robbery, anything like that, he's able to track the scent of that person and assist the law enforcement officers to try to catch that individual before he gets away if no one had seen him or if they had seen him but not able to run as fast as I guess a bad guy would
right.
be. He's able to either run him down, track him down, and apprehend him and hold him. For me, so we can work as a team and put the handcuffs on them.
Right. You talk about teamwork between you and your dog. How important is the relationship between you and Nico?
It's very important. You got to consider when the dog is already a full-grown shepherd when I received it. So the biggest thing is to get that bond between me and him that he knows, you know, I'm the one, you know, he wants to be with all the time, and he's to get to learn the different things that he does, such as the narcotics and tracking to, I guess, read him is the biggest thing I'm working with right now. He's always right 100% of the time so far, and I've always been wrong. So I've got to learn to
got a good nose for crime.
Yeah.
Does Nico have any special things that you have to do for him other than a normal dog would be at your house, say?
Yeah, he lives with me continuously, but the biggest thing is I got to be with him is I've got to. Instead of just regular house dog, you let lay around, I go be really strict with him. He doesn't get the bones to chew on. He doesn't get to play exactly every time he wants. It's more of a working type play. And when he does get his rewards, and which is a tennis ball or a tug, it's during work time and playing. And that's really hard for me because I have another dog at home that gets the run of the house. And when you have a dog that's you have to be so strict for,
right?
It's hard to do that. But that's one of the things.
And you have to go through every year, it's like a re-licensing certification kind of a thing with Nico, is that correct?
Yes, every year we have to, I certify him through the United States Police Canine Association, which is all over the United States, and we have two different regions in our state, and we take him and he has to do the apprehension, a box search, agility, obedience, and article searches. And he has to get a high enough score on that to get a certification. And he can even, if he gets high enough score, he can qualify him for the nationals, which are held in different states throughout each year.
Right, yeah. Okay. Well, I see time is almost up. I was going to run across the studio and get you to take him to pull me down on the ground. And
that wouldn't be a problem.
We don't have time for that, though, today, so sorry about that. But thanks a lot for coming on the show, Deputy Tadman. It's good to meet you and Nico.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
We'll be right back after this.
From the University of North Dakota, you're watching Studio One.
UND's Division of Continuing Education can help you learn throughout your lifetime. Begin or continue your education through correspondence study and learning after hours with classes on weekends and evenings. Or enhance your personal and professional development through conferences, management seminars, and specialized programs.
Our goal is to provide quality programs and extend UND resources to you.
For more information, call 777-4266 or 1-800-342-8230.
Don't you love that safe, free feeling you get in a pickup truck, Larry?
Yeah, nothing but you, me, the open road, a deer.
Yeah! A cow! Yeah! An ostrich!
Yeah! The village people!
The village people!
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
Especially in pickup trucks.
I didn't know the village people were doing a road tour.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota is steeped in tradition. From the first graduating class, students today learn from the Modern Law Library and computer labs. Students write for the North Dakota Law Review, take part in moot court, and review court proceedings with video technology. Law and medical students compete in the annual Malpractice Bowl.
The size of our student body gives great access to their teachers, and our computer network allows us to access worldwide legal resources.
Look up the UND School of Law for more opportunities.
Tune in next week on Studio One when we'll show you how one man's inspiration could be a model for everyone.
And we'll also explore the effects of loud music in cars. Bad hearing may be a high price to pay for good music. Plus, we'll give you the rundown on what's happening in entertainment and news. All that and more next week on Studio One.
And let's remember November 11th is Veterans Day, so let's remember our veterans. But now we're going to leave you with some pictures of some busy beavers hard at work. Compliments of the Busy Beaver Wood Carving Club.
That's
I got that out all right.
Tongue tire.
From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.